Welcome everyone, my name is Nick Tax and I'm a machine learning scientist at Booking.com. And this is a joint collaboration with many machine learning practitioners and fraud specialists at Booking.com. First, I start off with a one slide summary of the whole paper. So what we do in this paper is we formulate an organizational model of how an anti-fraud department in an e-commerce organization actually operates. And then from this organizational model, we actually derive six topics that we believe are relevant when you do machine learning for fraud detection in e-commerce. And we derive them from this organizational model. And then we actually link these six research topics to the machine learning literature. So for each of the six research topics, we look at, okay, what kind of methods and subfields are there within the machine learning literature, and which of these subfields of machine learning actually already address or partially address aspects of these six research topics, and which aspects of them are maybe not yet addressed at all. And then from these aspects that are not yet addressed, we actually go on and we formulate 22 open research questions that we believe are relevant to still look into for machine learning applied to fraud detection. So here is the organizational model that we came up with. So on the left side, you see the users of the platform. There are genuine users and there are fraudulent users who are out there to make money out of the platform in all kind of shady and dubious ways. There is on the top, in the middle, there is the e-commerce platform itself. The users, actually, they interact with the platform by browsing and clicking around and then making their purchases, maybe or not, or registering their account, or they can interact with it in all kind of different ways. Then while they interact with the platform, all kind of data gets recorded about how they interact with the platform, and this ends up in different databases in the organization. From this data, we can derive features that we can later use to determine which fraudsters were fraudulent and which maybe were not. And then we have the data also consists of labels, and these labels actually are a representation of our belief of which users actually were fraudulent ones and which were not fraudulent ones. And note that this doesn't have to necessarily match the reality, because it might be that sometimes we don't yet have full knowledge of which users are fraudsters, or maybe it takes a while and we simply get this information only with delay. And then in the middle of the picture, centrally located, we have fraud investigators. The fraud investigators actually play a very, very important and central role in an anti-fraud organization. And what they do is they do analyses and case-by-case investigations to determine whether certain transactions or certain registrations or certain behavior on the website was actually fraud or whether it was legitimate. And if they decide that it was fraud, they can, for example, close the account again in the case of a fraudulent account registration, or they can try to undo a transaction in the case of a transaction. And then what you see, if they do that, this manual actioning of the fraud investigator, it actually impacts the fraudsters, because their fraud now no longer worked. And at the same time, it actually provides a label. So it feeds back into the data, and we now have figured out more about which instances were actually fraudulent. However, the fraud investigators do more than just these manual investigations. They also try to identify patterns among the different frauds that they see. And what they use this to formulate rules. And these rules can then later be used to automatically detect a new type of fraud. Then in the bottom right, you see actually the work product of the machine learning scientist. You see the machine learning model, which is trained from the features and the labels, tries to predict what is fraudulent and what is not, This can be a model in the general sense. It could be an anomaly detection model, it could be supervised model, or in the broader sense, it's just some kind of model. Then you have some decision components, some decision-making system, as we call it. And this decision-making system has to make a decision based on the output of the model, on the output of all the rules that are put in production by the fraud investigators. And it has to make a certain kind of decision. One decision could be simply be to do nothing if the decision system believes it is not a fraudulent case. However, if it believes that it is a case of fraud, the decision-making system still needs to make a decision on whether to make an immediate automated action. Like the decision-making system can itself immediately block the registration or block the transaction, or the decision-making system can decide to instead not make an automated action, but instead simply escalate the case to the fraud investigator, who can then have a deeper look and a manual look at it, and then decide to take a manual action later if needed. So then there is one more component on the slide that I haven't explained yet, and this is the escalation. The escalation simply represents everything external to the system that can additionally trigger investigations or provide information on what is fraud or not. You can think here about, for example, a customer service department who might get a phone call which might put us on the track of investigating a certain transaction. Or you can think here about credit card agencies who might give a notification of fraud. And this might trigger investigations, or in some cases they might simply already fully tell us that certain behavior was fraud, and this, in that case, it can simply immediately feed into the labels. So now we start looking at the six research topics that we derive from this model. And the first one that we believe is important is investigation support. So you have this fraud investigator here in the middle. The fraud investigators don't have resources to investigate all the behavior. So they need to be selective in what we can investigate and not. And they need to be efficient, but they still need to be to block as much of the fraud as possible. And here we believe that there is a role for machine learning simply to support the decision-making process by making the decision-making more effective, of higher quality, and more efficient. Then there is a decision-making component here in the bottom. We believe that decision-making is a vital research topic, and important aspects and non-trivial aspects to it are, for example, how do we combine the rules with the model output into a single decision, and when we think, and even if the decision-making system thinks that something is fraud, when to make an automated action and when to escalate something to a fraud investigator. Then there is the topic of labels, which brings all kinds of challenges. One challenge, for example, is the fact that in the case of an automated action, the decision-making system simply itself blocks something, but that means that this has never been manually looked at by a fraud investigator, and we can't actually be fully certain that it actually was fraud. We simply haven't gotten the feedback. And that means you might never get the labels for the instances where you take automated action. And this might create some selection bias in your data. On the other hand, there is another challenge related to labels is label delay. It might simply be that it simply takes a long time for our labels to be available for us. They're not immediately available for us for our model training. And there's even more complex things going on here, because we have different routes in this model where our labels come in. They come in through the manual actioning of the fraud investigator, but they also come in through the escalations. And these two sources of labels might not have the same time distribution in the delays. So we end up with a very complex multimodal time distribution in the label delays. Then there's the problem of concept drift. It's very easy to see from this picture why concept drift actually occurs, because you see that this is a closed loop. So from the users, they interact with the platform that generates data. From that follows a model, and the model kind of actually partially steers which fraudulent users actually are impacted and whose fraud is being blocked. And for the fraudsters whose fraud are blocked, they are likely to start to try new types of attacks. So they simply need to start working around the system. And this creates all kind of new behavior. Then we have the model investigator interaction. And this research topic focuses on the interaction between the model and the investigator, not only about what instances the model shows to the investigator, but also about what instances should we show to the fraud investigator such that the model itself gets useful feedback to itself improve in the next training iteration. And then finally, we have all kinds of aspects related to the model itself. So we summarize all this in the table with these research areas. And in the rightmost column, we link this to different areas of machine learning research. However, we don't have time to go into all six, so we will actually now just zoom in to one of them. And the rest is described in the paper. So we focus on the concept drift and on the research challenges that we formulate for those. So related to the concept drift, we have again this loop. The first challenge here is that not all change of behavior that we see actually comes from behavior change of the fraudsters. So this is adversarial drift when the fraudsters change their behavior. However, just as frequent is the fact that simply the user interface or other parts of the e-commerce platform simply change. There's simply new code being deployed and rolled out. And that might simply already change how also the genuine users interact with the platform. And this creates a challenge for concept drift detection techniques to try to distinguish and separate the adversarial change coming from the change of behavior of the fraudsters from the natural change and the non-adversarial change that comes simply from deployments of new e-commerce platforms. And then the same aspect actually plays a role in novelty detection. So novelty detection is a subfield of machine learning focused on finding subgroups of the data that are haven't been observed before, but are now emerging in the data and getting more common. It is important also there to try to separate which emerging novel data types are actually adversarial drift from the fraudsters and which one originate from changes in the e-commerce platform. We can also try to be ahead of concept drift, and we can simply analyze the e-commerce platform and see what could be all the ways in which fraudsters could use this to exploit it for fraud. And if we would be able to do that, and we believe that attack trees, for example, could be a useful method here, we could try to somehow incorporate this into the machine learning model and bring in domain knowledge of ways in which we believe that the data might change. And then there's a research area called adversarial robustness in AI, which focuses on making the machine learning model robust to certain types of adversarial change in the data. However, most of the methods in this field focuses on computer vision or on textual data. And there's only limited work on adversarial robustness for tabular data, while actually that is the data domain that we are most dealing with in the fraud detection area. And as another research challenge, we believe that it is important to find ways to balance and combine anomaly detection with supervised methods. Because we know that supervised methods are the most accurate way of fraud detection to catch recurring type of frauds that have happened many times over in the past and still keep happening. While anomaly detection methods are our only way to try to stop new types of fraud that we've never seen before. So how can we combine both type of methods in a joint way to try to block both types of different types of fraud? And finally, there exists concept drift adaptation methods in the literature that try to make the model adapt to new types of data. However, it's still a big challenge of how to do this in the label delay setting. And we know that our labels come in late. And we know actually that our label delay has particular characteristics, like this bimodal distribution because of the two different label sources that I explained earlier. And investigating this effect of that on the concept of drift adaptation is still a big open challenge. Thank you. This is all the time I have. If you're interested in more about practical aspects of applied machine learning in fraud detection, please have a look at the paper or feel free to reach out.